There's an old joke. Two elderly women are at a Catskill Mountain resort, and one of them says, "Boy, the food at this place is really terrible." The other one says, "Yeah, I know, and such small portions." Well, that's essentially how I feel about life, full of loneliness and misery and suffering and unhappiness, and it's all over much too quickly.
Mid-60s, Woody Allen cashed in on his nerdy, nebbish persona, doing stand-up comedy, writing novels, actually feeling very uncomfortable in front of an audience. In the mid to late 60s, he started getting movie roles, but sometimes a supporting role and barely a supporting role at that. Woody's next film, you know what, he decided, you know what, man? I'm going to star, write, and direct the rest of my movies. And that's exactly what he did with Take the Money and Run, his fake crime documentary, which was an instant classic. It put him on the map immediately. Woody Allen has the reputation of casting his real-life girlfriends in his films, starting with Bananas with Louise Lazer. And then the follow-up, Everything You Always Wanted to Know About Sex, based on a very famous sex novel at the time, Woody added, but were afraid to ask. Vignettes, short stories, the best, Gene Wilder leaving his wife for a sheep. Then in 1973, the start of six collaborations with real girlfriend Diane Keaton, starting with Sleeper, considered his greatest early comedy. At this point in Woody's career, you could really feel the Chaplin, the Marx Brothers, and the Bob Hope influence just come through in his comedy. The next year, Love and Death, a spoof on the novel War and Peace. And then in 1977, it all changed. The turning point, beating out Star Wars and Close Encounters of the Third Kind for Best Picture, Annie Hall came home with four Academy Awards, including Best Picture. And now Woody Allen was no longer considered a slapstick director. He was now considered a profound filmmaker. Everyone wanted to work with him. The follow-up would be Manhattan, shot in glorious black and white. Cinematographer Gordon Willis, who worked on The Godfathers 1 and 2. Woody Allen has now hit his absolute prime in filmmaking. The greatest film he did with Mia Farrow in the 80s was Hannah and Her Sisters. Seven Academy Award nominations. Some believe this is Woody Allen's greatest work. More or less a drama, Michael Caine steals the show. The second greatest film of the 80s, Crimes and Misdemeanors. Three Academy Award nominations. Heading into the mid-2000s, Woody Allen departed from New York filming and for the first time filmed in the United Kingdom, in England. Starring Scarlett Johansson, this was the darkest film Woody Allen has ever made, with a Hitchcockian twist. Critics were blown away by this film. Match Point became his most profound film to date.
Hey now.
Soon after, Lestat the Vampire was released from the Ramier Brothers, I immediately started hounding Robert, actually asking him, "So what are you guys going to do next? Have you two thought of anything?" And he's like, "Nah, it's too soon. And I was like, "You know, it would be really cool to do Colonel Kurtz, Marlon Brando, and Apocalypse Now." And he's like, yeah, wow, you know, that is a good idea for a figure. But he's like, if you want to do one, Scott, we could do a one-off, and I'll help you. And I was like, I mean, we could just pick any character and just, you know, make a one-off. He's like, yeah. I was like, you know what? Here's the actual COA with the major players involved. In the bottom right, you'll see one of one. And this is Jake's COA for the paint job, and he did a lot more. We'll get into that later. This is just sort of like a box sleeve that I designed, and this is like the whodunit. It's like everyone involved that's not on the COA. So to speed things up, Rob and I split, you know, different parts of the figure and worked with different artists all at the same time, which made sense. So everything on the left in yellow will be the artists and the parts Rob dealt with. On the right in blue will be the artists and sections I dealt with. We needed a certain style of body because Woody is shorter. Jay Sullivan provided us with a Marty McFly body, and Pete fit the head perfectly. So this project took a little under 2 years. Now, when we first started, Rob and I, we actually had a different head sculpt for this project. With saying that, I mean, we hired a different artist sculptor altogether on the right. Now you could see the difference, but at the time when I would bounce this head sculpt off friends and stuff, they'd say, wow, you know, it looks good, it looks like him. And I wasn't sold, you know, but I also am more familiar with Woody Allen than the people I was sharing this image with. And I'm really glad that I switched gears sort of and convinced Rob, it's just not there. It's more of a caricature of him, you know. And I believe Jacob might have given his brother Rob the connect of using Charitha, our second sculptor, which is on the left. And working with him was very, very simple, very little dialogue, very little back and forth. I didn't give Charitha the sculptor any direction or reference photos of the back of Woody's head with the bald spot, and he had the foresight to make that for us. So we're going to return to the head sculpt and discuss the portrait and Jacob's paint, but I'm purposely putting this clothing under this bright light because I need the light to hit those grooves in the jacket. It's not exactly a corduroy, but it's unbelievably well made. All the stitching is top-notch. I'm not 100% where Robert found Aaron Marka, the tailor. The pants are phenomenal. They have this really beautiful, I love these crumpled look. I love that. It's so Woody Allen. The pants on the surface, I'll try and show you, they have this really soft, soft texture. Of course, the outfit is based on one of the scenes in Annie Hall, and the shirt here has the magnet type that slips into the seam to represent a buttoned shirt. It works really well. Our painter, Jacob, actually spent a good amount of time modifying the body, the clothes, so let's get into that. To illustrate what Jacob did, it's easier with the head off. He dyed that undershirt. He sewed the shirt neck smaller, sewed the back of the shirt tighter, added some padding on the shoulders and chest, added that belt. Our original belt did not work. As far as the sneakers, Jake added feet. He weathered the sneakers, which is a great idea. He tightened the laces up, glued the tongue gap closed. So as always, Jacob Bramier just crushed this thing paint-wise. It looks like I'm getting weird shines on it. It's not paint rubs, but it looks weird. There's a lot of highlights he did in the hair, because as a younger man, Woody Allen had very red hair, and as he got older, it just got browner. But you have all these different color variations going in there, so Jake really did his homework. He did such a great job. So deciding on an accessory, if I were to add one, I thought the bookstore scene in Annie Hall, The Denial of Death. And I turned to my good buddy Hunter, who's done some work for me in the past, and his father actually made this for me. And they did the research. They've got the binding in the back of the book. I couldn't find that online. So they made me three, and I was very happy, and they did a great job.
That's pretty serious stuff there.
Yeah, because I'm obsessed with death, I think. It's a big subject with me, yeah. I have a very pessimistic view of life. You should know this about me if we're going to go out. You know, I feel that life is divided up into the horrible and the miserable. Those are the two categories, you know. The horrible would be like, I don't know, terminal cases, you know, and blind people, and cripples. I don't know how they get through life. It's amazing to me, you know. And the miserable is everyone else. So when you go through life, you should be thankful that you're miserable.
So as far as the glasses, Andy from Doggy Doc Design works with Robert on those. We had a small hiccup when I first got the package, no fault to Andy. The box just rattled around and the lenses popped. So I shipped the head sculpt back to Andy and he fixed it in no time. Now they're mounted to the head. They should not come off. They're not removable. So now I can have Woody stand with his hero, comedian Charlie Chaplin.